everyone. I think maybe one more minute and then leave.
Yeah, there's still quite a few people joining, so I think another minute would be good. I think we're okay now, Eunice.
Great.
Great, then I guess we'll get started. Hi, I'm Lisa Anderson-Olivier. I'm the City of Salem's Planning Administrator. I wanna thank everybody for coming today and joining us on this nice snowy day here in the Valley. The meeting is being recorded, so if you have to leave early or you wanna share it with other people afterwards, we will be posting it. Shelby put in the chat, but in case you didn't see it, there's going to be a Q&A at the end. If you have questions, if you could just type them in and we'll go through them at the end, that would be helpful. We are co-hosting this meeting, City of Salem, with City of Kaiser and DLCD. So first I want to ask Shane to introduce himself.
Thanks, Lisa. I'm Shane Witham. I'm the planning director for the City of Kaiser. Again, I just want to reiterate what Lisa said. We thank you guys all for attending. I think we're excited that you're here. And I guess, Eunice, I will say, I'll introduce, I'm here from the City of Kaiser, and Dina Horner, our system planner, is also on the call listening in for Kaiser staff people that are here. And then, I don't know, Lisa, do you want to introduce Salem staff, and we can introduce the LCD staff as well?
Sure. How about Eunice and then Julie? You want to introduce yourself?
Sure. I'm Eunice Kim, long-range planning manager with the City of Salem.
Hi, I'm Julie Warnicki. I'm the Transportation Planning Manager for the City of Salem.
And then we have Kevin and then Evan.
Good afternoon. My name is Kevin Young. I'm a Senior Urban Planner with DLCD, which is the Department of Land Conservation and Development. Evan?
Yeah, hi, folks. Evan Manvel. I'm a Climate Mitigation Planner at DLCD. My pronouns are he, him.
And I think we have staff here from the Council of Governments. You guys want to introduce yourselves? Maybe not. I sprung it on them. I don't think I told them I was going to call them, but we do have technical staff here from the Council of Governments to help answer questions. I also see that we have some elected and appointed officials, both from Salem and Kaiser. So we want to welcome you and thank you for attending today. Eunice, if you want to go to the next slide, I think Shane's going to talk about the purpose of the meeting.
Sure. Thanks, Lisa. Yeah, so today, kind of our intention here is to, we already kind of did our introductions, but the purpose of the meeting really is to give an overview of what we are looking at what we're calling walkable mixed use areas. And the DLCD staff is here. They're going to share some background information on the climate friendly and equitable communities rulemaking process and the rules that are now in effect that, cities like ours are going to be implementing. We are in the process of studying and designating walkable mixed use areas in both Salem and in Kaiser. And so we're going to spend a little time with Salem staff's going to talk a little bit about what they're doing in Salem, what they're looking at, and kind of what their next steps are, and Kaiser will do the same. So it really is, we're intending for it to be informational, but we also want to not just be an introduction to the concept and the work that we're embarking on and in the middle of, but also really an opportunity for you that are here to ask your questions and to get more information. And I know Salem staff, just like Kaiser staff, were very available after these meetings to continue to have conversations. So this is kind of a starting point for us. And I just wanted to say, I thank City of Salem because they really spearheaded putting this meeting together, since these climate friendly and equitable rules really do affect our whole region. It was a great opportunity for us to kind of come together and share, you know, Kaiser and Salem are different, but we are connected and we are part of the same area. So that's kind of what the meeting will look like. And we know it's at your lunch hour. So we're going to try to be somewhat brief and give plenty of time for those questions at the end. And I think if you have questions that pop up in the midst, feel free to put those into the chat. We may tackle them at the time, but we may kind of wait and try to take those at the end. So anyway, but that would be great. And I think with that, we will turn it over to, I believe, Evan.
Yes, thank you, Shane. I appreciate that. Thanks everyone for joining us today. So Climate Friendly and Equitable Communities is a program that our commission and department created over a couple of years. Our commission adopted the rules in 2022, and now we're implementing the program along with our local partners and community members. And the goal of the program is, as its title might suggest, twofold. One is to cut climate pollution tied to transportation, our largest single sector of transportation climate pollution in Oregon. And the second is to promote equity. Next slide. So climate pollution, we as a state are off track from our legislative goals. The legislative said it's the policy to cut our climate pollution significantly by 2050 and some benchmarks along the way. And you can kind of see that growing gap over the next 30 years. We're really, if we keep on our current trajectory, going to have four times as much climate pollution from transportation as our goal is. So that's a real problem. It's a real problem in part because extreme weather events that are made more frequent and more extreme by climate disruption are already having significant impacts on Oregonians. People are losing their lives. People are losing their homes. People are having some losing some business problems. So we really said, how do we course correct? How do we get back on track towards or to meet Oregon's goals? And we're part of a larger multi-agency program. Other folks are taking other parts of transportation pollution, but these rules do their part to try to course correct. Next slide. So the second main thrust of the rules is equity, and equity, because Oregon's land use and transportation systems have historically really increased inequity and been kind of a way for privileged folks to concentrate wealth and less privileged folks to get harmed by those systems. Those decisions from redlining to exclusionary zoning to where we locate highways and that sort of thing. And we're still seeing those impacts of those past practices because, of course, intergenerational wealth is mainly passed through homes, property. And that means that today, even at the same income levels, there's a huge gap between home ownership between white and black households. For example, the average white household has about 10 times the wealth as the average black household. And that makes it so there's a real problem there. caused by our past actions, and we're trying to do some course correction there as well to make sure that all Oregonians have housing and transportation choices they can afford. Next slide. The program applies just in the 8 metropolitan areas in Oregon. It doesn't apply to the coast or Eastern Oregon or in the Gorge, really where most Oregonians live, and we thought we could get the most bang for our buck in improving our transportation choices and helping people get around by not driving or taking shorter car trips and moving the needle that way. Of course, Salem-Keizer is one of those. Yeah, thanks, Eunice. So there are 2 main thrusts of the program. The first is regional plans to achieve pollution reduction targets. And we're not gonna get into that in detail, but the Salem-Keizer region is one of the 2 regions that's gonna take that on. The Portland Metro region has already done that work, but it's kind of a collaborative regional look to say, hey, how do we as a region do our part to meet climate pollution reduction goals? What sorts of actions can we take? What's the right mix that the models say, yes, that'll reduce climate pollution here? So that's a separate process that's working its way through with Salem and Keizer and Marin County. The second main thrust of the rules is just changing Oregon's core land use and transportation rules. And these are kind of these are the rules that our commission and department say, hey, local plans have to meet these standards. And so it's really updating a variety of those to make sure that we can do better than we have. Next slide. Thank you. Sorry if my kid's screaming is too loud. Snow day. Anyway, good. So there are 6 main areas our commission directed us to take on when we were updating our transportation and housing rules. 3 kind of in the land use realm and 3 in our transportation planning rules. The first of which we'll go into in depth in a moment about walkable mixed use areas. I won't say anything more of that. The second is reforming parking management. Parking management has a significant impact on the housing costs and business costs and how people get around. The third is doing a little bit more to make sure that we're future-proofing for electric vehicle charging as the market expands, that as we're building new buildings, that there's some conduit there so people can easily put in the wires and chargers as the demand increases. On the transportation planning side, kind of 3 main thrusts. First is really trying to turn the volume up on how well we're doing on planning for walking and biking and transit and rolling. Just making sure that those systems and networks are planned and we're getting ready to build those out in a better way. The second is thinking about success in multiple ways, not just saying, hey, I have some delay in my car, but hey, let's think about safety or choices or some other things. So you can continue to think about congestion, but your cities and counties have to think about other factors as well when they're measuring success. And the third is developing a list of projects in their transportation plan that collectively can meet various things, including some climate and equity outcomes. So that's the thrust of the transportation planning. But we're mainly here to talk about walkable mixed use areas. So I will turn the microphone over to my colleague, Kevin Young.
Thank you, Evan. I really appreciate the context for this. Yeah, we're really, our goal today is to really focus on the walkable mixed use areas, talk about the process, the requirements. I think also Eunice and Shane will be speaking to, you know, how this work actually dovetails pretty nicely with some local planning work that's been done in the region. So I'm really happy to see that. So next slide, please. So first of all, let's start by discussing what is a walkable mixed use area. Well, it's an area that's walkable that contains a mixture of uses. It's not really a new idea. It's actually a very old idea. A lot of our older downtown areas that developed before, you know, we started zoning things so that houses are here and jobs are here and, you know, businesses are there. We put everything in closer proximity back in the old days because people were walking more, they were using transit more. You know, it was just kind of a necessity. And So these are areas that might resemble your historic downtowns. They might be neighborhood centers, but fundamentally what they contain is areas on a walkable scale that contain a mixture of uses. So residential, office, retail, services. One really important aspect of the walkable mixed use area is that it makes it easier to get around in a different way so that people can walk, they can bike, they can take transit to get from destinations, you know, here and there. And in doing so, reduce their reliance on vehicle trips. Are walkable mixed use areas for everyone? No, not necessarily. We are really, to meet our climate goals, as Evan showed you earlier in terms of the progress we're making, changing the way we do land use is a really important component to reducing climate pollution. And we also think it boosts equitable outcomes by providing more housing and employment opportunities that are less dependent on expensive and time-consuming vehicle travel. Lastly, one of the key characteristics for a walkable mixed-use area is that parking is well managed. So these areas are not dominated by large parking lots. Certainly vehicles are, you know, a component of a walkable mixed-use area, but not the transportation mode that really sort of dictates how everything is laid out in a walkable mixed-use area. Next slide, please. So in the rules that were adopted, in July of 2022, there are some locational requirements for walkable mixed use areas. So those, you know, are basically as you see on the screen here. So they should be located in existing or planned urban centers. That includes downtowns, transit served corridors, neighborhood centers. Areas provided again with high quality pedestrian, bike, and transit facilities, areas where the infrastructure is able to support potential development. So, you know, if you want to build more intensively in these areas, we have water and sewer service to meet those needs. Shouldn't be located in hazardous areas. That's an important characteristic. And there's a minimum dimensional standard for a walkable mixed use area of 750 feet. There are some exceptions in the rules, but generally, there needs to be sort of some degree of concentration to get that synergy we're looking for between, you know, people who live and work and meet more of their daily needs within these walkable mixed use areas. The work has already started to look at potential candidate areas in your region. The local council of governments is starting to look at potential walkable mixed use areas, and there will certainly be more outreach coming. I'll let the locals speak to that work, but it's pretty exciting. I think it's going very well in your region. In terms of the land use requirements for the walkable mixed use areas, allowing a broad variety of housing types, broad variety of offices, services, commercial and public uses. There's an allowance in the rules that abutting high density residential or employment areas can qualify as a portion of the walkable mixed use area. So in other words, we talk about mixed use, but if there's an existing, you know, major employer, for example, or high density residential area that abuts an otherwise mixed use area, those areas can also qualify towards the area requirements. The rules prioritize the location of public serving government facilities in these areas, and also notes that parks and open space areas should be in or near walkable mixed use areas, because what we don't want to create are these, you know, areas with no green space, with no amenities. We want these to be attractive and vibrant areas that people want to visit. There are minimum block length standards in the rules that gets to the walkable issue, that for pedestrians, you know, certain block lengths are going to work better for, again, meeting more of your daily needs on foot versus in a vehicle. And then also the rules stipulate no maximum density limitations. Instead, the building height established by the local government can serve as a density limitation in lieu of that residential density number. Next slide, please. So in terms of how the rules apply, they're scaled to population of the local government. So you can see in the column on the left-hand side there, based on population, Salem is a city over 50,000 population, Kaiser's between 25 and 50,000, basically. And so the standards are different there. And there are two paths for establishing the walkable mixed use areas. Both for both cities, the metric is essentially that the total walkable mixed use areas that are designated, it could be one or it could be multiple walkable mixed use areas, need to cumulatively allow for at least 30% of total housing needs to be accommodated in those areas. And that's based on zoned residential capacity. So it has to do with how intensively you can build, what portion of those areas would be considered, would qualify as residential or expected to be a residential development. So there's two paths for local governments to follow. They can choose the prescriptive option or the outcomes option. On the prescriptive option, there's essentially two standards there. So minimum densities and maximum allowed building height, no less than. And I'm sorry, that's kind of convoluted language, but what the building height standard means is that the local government needs to allow building heights up to that amount in these areas. So for example, for Kaiser, if they chose a prescriptive option, the minimum requirement for a single use residential building would be 20 dwelling units per acre. If it's a mixed use building that has commercial and residential, there's no minimum density applied. But again, if it was just an apartment building, for example, 20 units per acre would be the minimum density applied. And the code would essentially say you can build up to 60 feet in height in those zones. That's in what we call the primary CFA. So that they might say our most intensive walkable mixed use area is going to have those standards. If there are other walkable mixed use areas that are designated, then those could be constructed to a lesser standard. So again, if Salem were following the prescriptive path, minimum density, 25 dwelling units per acre, and allowing buildings up to 85 feet in height, doesn't require construction to that height. It simply allows for that development to happen. The alternative approach, the outcomes-oriented option, is for local governments that might say, hey, we have a code now, we have a development code now that we think accomplishes what you're trying to accomplish, or we're developing a code that we think is different from what's in the prescriptive option, but it will allow for the development of up to 30 homes and jobs per net acre in Kaiser's case, or up to 40 homes and jobs per net acre in Salem's case. It doesn't say you have to require that level of development. It says the development code needs to allow for that level of development. So I think that's an important distinction. Obviously, we can't require development to get every building to be at a certain height. But our goal here is to set the table, if you will, for the development that's, you know, going to be most beneficial in terms of the climate pollution reduction. I've seen a few questions in chat. I don't know if I should pause here for those or keep going. Let's see.
I think we're hoping to save them to the end.
Okay, that is totally fine. All right, let's go to the next slide, please. Okay, so the process, as I said, the study process is underway now, and the studies will be submitted to our department, Department of Land Conservation and Development, by December 31st of this year. So by the end of the year. The studies are not land use decisions. They're not subject to appeal. Basically, our department will review them and comment on them. This looks good, or maybe you could adjust here or there, or what have you. But again, it is not a decision in any way. It's really a study of potential walkable mixed use areas. And so what is included in those studies is, again, looking at what are the best walkable mixed use areas that we might designate, evaluating those current and potential development standards. So if you're looking at what does our code say now, if we take the prescriptive path, what should it be? Or if we take the outcome oriented path, you know, what alternative code are we proposing? There's also a requirement for a community engagement plan. So that covers both the study phase and also the zoning phase, which I'll talk about in a minute. And then one key component with this work is, again, getting at equitable outcomes is to evaluate the potential for displacement of underserved populations. So if there are areas under consideration where you're likely to price people out, if you upzone and the local government doesn't adopt mitigation measures, there might be that potential. First, what we're trying to do is to get ahead of any negative impacts, to identify that potential. And then there's a requirement with the zoning layer to adopt mitigation measures as the zoning is adopted, so that we don't see those negative outcomes. And as I said, studies will be submitted for review and comment by the department. In the next year, the local governments will determine and apply zoning for the walkable mixed use areas. And the deadline in our rules is December 31st, 2024. There is a process whereby local governments can request an extended deadlines for that. I'm pretty sure Salem and Kaiser have not made that request. So we're looking at December 31 of 2024. And by that date, at that point, the local government, you know, as part of a public engagement process, will go through the decision process of what will be our walkable mixed use areas and what zoning will we apply in those areas. In some cases, it may not be much of a change at all. In other cases, it may be a significant change. Again, for those cities over 10,000, which are both Salem and Kaiser, at the end of the day, the zone changes need to show that those walkable mixed use areas can accommodate at least 30% of needed housing within the community. Obviously, that housing may not be there today, but our hope is that it will develop over time. And then in conjunction with that is adoption of a walkable mixed use element into the comprehensive plan, which also talks about housing production strategies that might be used to mitigate for displacement impacts. And I can't remember if I have another slide. So let's go ahead and turn to the next slide. Okay. Just kind of big picture in terms of walkable mixed use areas. You know, we've talked about the climate benefits. There are other benefits to walkable mixed use areas. First of all, more opportunities for jobs and housing for those who want to work or live in these areas. And I think it's important to note that local governments don't need to make do any analysis to allow for more jobs and job employment and housing opportunities in these areas. They can simply make that possible for folks with the zoning changes. There's also the flexibility in zoning and methodology I've talked about a little bit. And I think also a key component is that these walkable mixed use areas do not reduce lands available for residential or employment growth elsewhere. So we're not saying, gee, everybody needs to live in a walkable mixed use area. We're providing that opportunity, but others who don't wish to live or work in those areas certainly aren't required to do so or expected to do so. So other types of development will still be possible in the future. Another key benefit of the walkable mixed use area regulations is an alternative transportation review process, which I would say is much less onerous and in many cases will be less expensive for local governments in terms of expected transportation infrastructure improvements. As I've noted earlier, you know, one of the key concerns that we're aware of is that potential for displacement. And To counteract that, our department, in conjunction with some other state agencies, has developed or is in the process of developing resources, both to evaluate that displacement and then identify mitigation strategies if needed. That may be my last slide. Yeah, I'll turn it over to the local government staff.
Great, thanks Kevin and Evan. So again, I'm Eunice with City of Salem and gonna be talking a little bit about Salem and how we're planning to implement these new rules. And then I'll turn it over to Shane. So to talk about Salem, I want to take a quick step backward and then before kind of looking forward, because in Salem, we've done a lot of planning work that really is forming the foundation for how we're going to be implementing the walkable mixed use areas going forward. So we've seen a lot of growth and development in the Salem area in recent years. So our city has really made it a priority to plan for that growth. Over the last 4 years, you might be aware, we worked with the community on a project called Our Salem, which really updated our comprehensive plan map, and our zoning code. So that project was approved last July and is now in effect. So during that project, we did a lot of outreach throughout the community to really understand what their vision was for how our community should grow and develop in the next few decades. We had a major focus on ensuring that we engaged and heard from our underrepresented communities, whether that was our communities of color, youth, people with disabilities, seniors, et cetera. While this project and this outreach was going on, the state rulemaking was happening at the same time. And so we were engaged in that rulemaking with DLCD from the beginning. So we're really fortunate in that we were able to incorporate some of the rules that were coming out of the Climate Friendly and Equitable Rulemaking Project into the Our Salem project that again was adopted in July. We're also fortunate in that a lot of the priorities and goals from those state rules align really well with the community's goals and priorities. One of the major goals is really around housing and mixed use. We've heard from Salem throughout the Our Salem project that the community wants to see more housing, more mixed use development near transit service. One of the reasons is that the more we can have people live near transit, the more likely they're able to take transit. One of our goals in the city is to become carbon neutral by 2050. We also have a climate action plan that really, again, calls for more growth near transit. So prior to the Our Salem project, we had some mixed use land. And so this map shows where our mixed use land was before, again, the big update to the comp plan and the comp plan map. But through Our Salem, we added more than 1,500 acres of mixed use land. So like Kevin was saying, our mixed use land is where housing is allowed, retail, offices, restaurants, or any combination of those types of uses. Our mixed use land doesn't require that mixed use development, your traditional kind of mixed use building be developed, but it is an option. Now, most of our mixed use land after Our Salem is within a quarter mile of the core network. The Chariots Core Network is essentially our frequent transit routes. So if you think commercial, Lancaster, these are frequent transit routes that Chariots has committed to keeping service on and increasing service in the future. And that way we're really able to plan around those routes, right? Because it's a bus line, it could move. So because there's some certainty in where that core network is going to be in the future, we've planned around it. So again, we're looking to increase the amount of housing and mixed-use development that can be developed in those areas. So based on all of that work, as we turn to kind of the walkable mixed use work that's coming from the state, we're really gonna build off of Our Salem. We have packaged all of the work from walkable mixed use areas, parking reform, transportation planning, all the things that Evan talked about in terms of the rules. We've packaged that into a project called Salem in Motion. So you'll start seeing this logo. We have a website and you can find information there. So in terms of the walkable mixed-use areas in the Salem area, we're really focusing on their inner core, places in and around downtown, where we've already heard from the community that they want to see more walkable, higher density mixed-use areas. We've been working with the Council of Governments to know that we need roughly 2,600 units, or the capacity for roughly 26,000 units, to meet this new state rules. So like many communities and what Evan and Kevin were saying, our downtown really is the closest to already being a walkable mixed use area. know, you see those mixed use buildings. It's pretty dense downtown. We have wider sidewalks, transit service, transit center. So it really is our most like a walkable mixed use area already today. Our downtown is currently zoned Commercial Business District, CB. It's that area in pink on the map. We anticipate this area is going to be our primary walkable mixed use area. Many of our standards already align with the state rules. The area is roughly 130 acres in size. We have a minimum density already of 20 units per acre. But as Kevin said, we're a bigger city. We're held to a higher density for our walkable mixed use area. So we're going to need to increase that to 25 units per acre. We already don't have a maximum height, so we align there. Based on an analysis by the Council of Governments, we know this downtown area can accommodate half, or about roughly 50% of that 26,000. So this area in pink can accommodate roughly 13,000 units. So we need to look at other areas. So again, we're gonna look at areas in and around the downtown that we specifically have already rezoned to mixed use. So one of those areas for a potential secondary walkable mixed use area is the North Downtown. So part of the North Downtown is shown here in purple. We rezoned it to mixed use as part of the R. Salem project. And you've seen some mixed use, traditional mixed use buildings there already. And there's a frequent transit line that goes down the street. It has wider sidewalks. So again, it has the building blocks for a walkable mixed use area. The density is 15 units per acre, which meets the state rules. Previously, it was lower than that. So through R. Salem, again, because we knew these rules were coming, we increased it from 12 units per acre to 15 units per acre. And our maximum height is 65 feet. So looking ahead, because we've done a lot of the zoning and kind of planning work already around walkable mixed use areas, we're going to really be focusing on that question of displacement that Kevin talked about. Will the rezoning that we did and the planning work that we're doing result in any displacement or the potential for displacement? And if so, you know, how can we mitigate that? Are there ways to promote affordable housing? Or are there other ways that we can help ensure that people that live there now are not priced out? So that's what we're going to be focusing on this spring in Salem. We're going to be particularly focused on engaging our underrepresented communities, those most impacted by these planning decisions. And so you can stay tuned. This is our project website for Salem in Motion. We'll be putting all of this information, including this presentation, online there. I think now I'm going to be passing it over to Shane.
Thank you, Eunice. So I'll talk a little bit about Kaiser. And for those of you that are on your computers and your Kaiser folks, you know that Kaiser is not the same as Salem. Primarily, we don't really have a distinct downtown that currently exists. I grew up in Kaiser, and when somebody would say, meet me downtown, in my mind, that's downtown Salem. And I think that's most of us would look at it that way. But what we do have in Kaiser is we have our main kind of commercial corridor along River Road and Cherry Avenue. Of course, we also have the Kaiser Station development out near the freeway as well. And, you know, the city did quite a bit of work with a really robust public engagement process where we had a lot of meetings with a lot of different groups in town. When we looked at our River Road corridor, and ultimately our city council adopted the Kaiser Revitalization Plan in late 2019, I believe it was. And that basically kind of set the groundwork for us as we looked at these rules that were coming out for walkable mixed use areas. We said, boy, that seems a little bit familiar. You can do the next slide for me, Eunice. So with that revitalization plan, and the area in blue kind of shows the area we designated as this boundary, which included both commercial zoned properties, a couple different designations, some mixed use zoned properties, some residential zoned properties, and both medium, higher density and lower density. And we kind of looked at this overall area. What's interesting about our plan is that it wasn't necessarily climate focused as much as it was opportunity-based focused. But interestingly enough, I think there was a lot of collateral benefits that came out of that. And you know, primarily the plan, when we went through the process, we ultimately chose to rezone all of our commercial properties to mixed use. So our core along River Road already is zoned mixed use. However, there's not a ton of mixed use, classic mixed use buildings that are developed. The intention of the plan was to allow and encourage those mixed use opportunities for folks that will be both opportunities for jobs, for housing, and ultimately to create a vibrant overall place where people want to go and ways for them to get there. Because the plan also identified that quality transportation facilities for transit, for walking, for biking are a necessity to make those places work. And then we went a little deeper and we designated these three individual centers, one in the north part of town, one in the center of town, and one in the south part of town, and basically identified those as some opportunity areas where we would see some even greater intensity of uses. You can go to the next slide. And, you know, realistically, we have seen a couple, and when I say a couple, like two mixed-use projects that have actually been constructed, one that just got finalized off of Cherry Avenue, one on River Road that happened fairly early. They're kind of what I would refer as maybe a little bit mixed-use light. They're not huge projects, but it kind of gives a little bit of a flavor of what that vision or that plan was looking to move the city toward as far as allowing for, as properties redevelop, then, you know, more opportunity than was there before. You know, one of the advantages of our River Cherry corridor is that it is served by frequent transit. And then the other thing that as we looked at it, we already adopted the plan, and in doing so, we adopted a new zoning overlay district for that area. And a lot of the standards that are surrounding walkable mixed use areas are fairly similar to those standards that we already have in place. So that's kind of where we're choosing to look and to focus our attention, because our community in general has already said, hey, this is kind of the appropriate area that we want to see this type of development. You can do the next slide for me. And so, as I said, as we're looking forward, we're basically looking to build off of that Kaiser revitalization plan. We did not recently go through a large comp plan update like Salem did, but we did go through this revitalization plan. And so I affectionately refer to the walkable mixed use areas as sort of a revitalization 2.0. You know, our 30% requirement, and council government has done some great work for us with technical analysis and helping us kind of truth out what our needs are and what the possibilities are. Because frankly, with some of the rules, I wasn't sure exactly how this or if this could work in Kaiser and what it would mean for us to designate these areas. But our 30% requirement, it equates to roughly 5,200 units or what we need to plan for. And so we looked at the River Cherry Overlay District, we looked at a few different options, and ultimately landed on, you know, we think the centers make a lot of sense as a starting point to look at, because they're already intended to be developed more intensely or possibly be more intensely developed. And so we looked at those because they have some different design standards and some different requirements. So as I said, you know, I think those walkable mixed use areas and the requirements in the state rules, there is a pretty high level of consistency with our standards in our River Cherry Overlay District. And obviously the technical analysis is a key element for us to figure out the capacity that's needed and what that consistency is. And so we're in the midst of doing that work, as I said, with the help of the Council of Governments. You can go to my next slide. And so as it stands right now, as we look at those three centers, our kind of next steps that we're looking at doing as a community is we want to take the work, the draft work that we're at right now, we want to reach out and go through our community diversity and engagement committee at the city level to get some input to talk about specifically with some of the initial equity analysis considerations and locational considerations that we're talking about. And then we're planning on following that up. We're shooting for April, actually, but we're shooting to have a public open house, kind of a drop-in type of format, and we're hoping to have that be well attended by folks that are in these areas or that have interest in these areas, and frankly, city as a whole, to get some input from the community to make sure that our reasoning is on the right track with what they want to see done in Kaiser. I would point out, like, there are a few things. I mean, and I saw some questions in the chat earlier. In Kaiser specifically, I will say that there are some changes that will need to happen in our existing standards to fully comply. We don't have a specific minimum density standard that's as high as it would need to be. We do have a maximum density standard, which of course that would need to go away. We have seen a few projects, one apartment complex that's under construction right now, that from a density perspective, it would kind of fit in that wheelhouse, but these new standards would have allowed more than what they were able to build. The other thing is our building height in Kaiser, the maximum building height in Kaiser in this area is 50 feet. So that would obviously have to be increased at least to 60 feet unless the city chose to go even higher. So that's just kind of a couple of things. And I think that was my last slide, if I remember. Yeah, so I think with that, we're kind of ready to tackle some questions and answers, hopefully.
Yep, we are. Thank you, everybody. And I'm just going to go through the questions, and hopefully any of the staff that feel like they can answer it will jump in. First question, which maybe we answered after it was put, is how tall can the buildings be? Eunice, you want to jump in and answer
that? Yeah, sure. So that depends on whether the walkable mixed-use area is a primary or secondary. Our primary walkable mixed-use area, which would be the downtown, has to be 85 feet, I think, is where the rule is. Our secondary ones, we're looking at 65, but I hope that answers the question.
Great. Thanks for that question, Ryan. Jonathan is wondering about what kind of pushback the cities or agencies have faced in this project. Anybody want to talk about pushback we've received as far as parking reductions or trying to increase mixed use?
I can speak to from a Kaiser perspective. I would say that we haven't received a ton of pushback yet because we are kind of at the beginning stages of this project. However, we as a community have heard quite often concerns about parking reductions and things like that. So that is something that we're sensitive to in trying to weigh how to best handle those kinds of concerns. I know that I've sat through several webinars that the LCD has graciously put on for local governments and people who are interested in talking about parking reform. And I think the one thing to note is that there is a pretty strong belief and a pretty strong evidence that generally speaking, a lot of times parking is somewhat self-regulatory and that developers that want to come in, develop projects, they kind of know what their market needs are and what's going to be successful. And so they generally, you know, there's places where there's no parking and they're ultra successful. There's other places that say, hey, we need some parking. And so that is something that I think there is definitely concerns in the Kaiser community, at least on that, especially because we don't have that classic downtown core where you maybe park once and walk. That's not how we are have historically been developed. So that would be the Kaiser perspective.
Yeah, Julie, Eunice, you want to add anything from Salem? Or I think I would say we're hearing the same things, although we do have a traditional downtown, but yeah. Okay, I see nods. Great, thanks, Shane. Perry was wondering about cost of proposals and who will pay for them and if this proposal would impact people's property taxes. What do you want to jump in on that one?
Is that cost of doing the work?
Yeah, I think that's how I read the question. So I guess we would say the cost of development is on the developer. What we're talking about is creating a framework for how people can develop within that framework. Generally, somebody building a mixed-use building in one part of town won't impact the property taxes on somebody else's property, and property tax increases are capped in Oregon. So hopefully that answers your question, Perry. Thank you for that.
I just jump in here. I think this the way I read the question, it's also talking about some of the displacement concerns. And so that's something that we are specifically looking at this spring, is trying to identify what is that risk of displacement from making the mixed-use zoning changes that we have made and what mitigation strategies might exist. And there's a toolkit of like a whole bunch of different ideas that the state has provided, and we're sort of working to sort through that and figure out what might work for Salem.
Great, thank you, Julie. Ryan, will there be high density mixed use buildings? That's our hope, what we hope for. Perry had a long comment in here, so I'd encourage you, if you have a chance, to go read his comment. At the end, he's urging us to stress the importance of addressing income inequality as these proposals go forward, which I think is what Julie was just talking about. So thank you for that comment. Sadie is giving us a shout out for outreach on our Salem. Thank you, Sadie. Also from Sadie, what's the north boundary of the north downtown area in Salem? Eunice, it's a good question.
I think that's good question, Sadie. Norway, maybe? Hood? No, maybe up towards Norway.
Yeah, but I think the mixed use goes a little north of Pine Street. So.
Yeah.
Ryan's wondering about Ward 4. So Ward 4 is very far south Salem, south of Kubler. So it's not going to be designated as a walkable mixed use area through this project, but through our Salem, we did rezone areas in Ward 4 to mixed use. So most of the land along Commercial Street, and then some of the land on the south side of Kubler at the intersection of Kubler and I-5 has been rezoned to mixed use.
And I would add, I think one of the challenges / opportunities is that we did rezone, right, a lot of land in Salem through the Our Salem project and created a bunch of new mixed use zones. So any changes that we make for the walkable mixed use areas, while we might be drawing a circle around kind of inner downtown, inner West Salem, north downtown, those changes will be made to the mixed use zones or improvements. When we look at transportation, we're not just going to look at downtown. We're going to look at our mixed use corridors where there's frequent transit. So it's kind of complicated because we've done some work and we're building on the work through our Salem while also incorporating the new state rules. So even if you don't have a circle around your mixed use South Commercial or Lancaster, it doesn't mean we're not going to be planning for walkable mixed use areas in those areas.
Great. And Kathy has a question for Kaiser. Number of vacant land parcels along River Road in Kaiser. Is the city offering any incentive to have those developed into more mixed use developments, marketing, reduced SDCs, et cetera? Shane.
Yes, thank you. And Kathy, thank you for your question. I would say that currently, no. However, part of this project that we're going to be looking at are, I won't say necessarily incentive-based, but part of our equity analysis work that we're going to be doing as a part of this looks at displacement and mitigation factors. And so I anticipate that that is a discussion that we will be looking at, as far as there may be some things like reduced SDCs or things like that, that may be something that may be a mitigating factor that we want to employ. Ultimately, as a city, we will have to come up kind of with some strategies as to how to deal with any kind of impacts that are identified from the equity analysis portion of the work. I think I know probably a couple of the properties you're talking about, and there are some SDC credits available. They wouldn't be reduced SDCs, but there are some identified transportation improvements necessary. And those would be SDC credit eligible for a developer if they came in on certain properties, but that has to do with what's already been identified in our current transportation system plan. In the not too distant future, as we go through this work and also subsequent scenario planning work, both Kaiser and Salem are anticipating moving right into, or even kind of concurrently, working to update our transportation system plans to kind of align some of these changes. So I would expect that there may be some, you know, our current transportation system plan is a 2009 document. So we're expecting to update that, and there may be opportunities for that, but ultimately those overall decisions have not been made as of yet. Sorry, that was a really long answer. My bad.
Well, that was great. Next question is, what does an overlay zone mean? You want to take that one, Shane?
Sure. I think I probably used that term and didn't explain that. So in Kaiser, if it is a Kaiser question, Susan and Wes, the overlay district is essentially you have your base zoning, which is mixed use. And then on top of that, we have what's called the River Cherry Overlay District, because we have other mixed use zoning in different parts of town. But within that overlay district, there's some special provisions, or really I like to refer to them as allowances, because it really is more allowances. And so that's kind of how our overlay district or our overlay zone works. So it's kind of a nerdy planner term, I guess.
Yeah, think of them as stacked on top of each other. Yeah. Question from Mike. How do we reconcile the efforts around displacement with the fact that this type of mixed use housing is almost exclusively rental housing and thus detracts from minority communities' abilities to use home ownership opportunities to contribute to the generational wealth identified by Evan during his intro?
Yeah, I think maybe I can speak to that a little bit. And thank you for the question, Mike. This is an issue we talked about a lot in the rulemaking process. We had a 40-member rulemaking advisory committee. We had folks, realtors, home builders, local governments, community-based organization representatives, a lot of people at the table and a variety of perspectives there. But one of the things that, you know, this issue was raised, because you're absolutely right. It, you know, home ownership is a key wealth building tool for many Americans. And it is a challenge. But I do want to stress that we are not talking solely about apartment buildings. That part of the work that we did was to look at other types of housing that are more affordable generally than detached single family. So attached single family, rather than detached, you know, row house style development actually can meet many of the density standards in the walkable mixed use area rules. We also looked at the variety of middle housing types, including triplexes, quadplexes, even cottage clusters, and found that yes, they could be accommodated and comply with the densities in the rules. The other point is too that, you know, the condominium process does provide for some ownership opportunities, even if the, you know, you're looking at multiple stacked units in what might otherwise look like an apartment building. We know that currently condominium law is complicated, and so we don't see as many of those types of things done today. And we're hopeful that, you know, we can over time see some improvements. But I think the big picture here is that with the new rules, we're accommodating a pretty broad variety of housing types, many of which can be fee simple owned and would be wealth building tools for folks who buy into them.
Great, thank you, Kevin. Next question from Robert. Eunice said the COG analysis says there's zone capacity for 13,000 units in downtown Salem. The question is, how many housing units are currently planned for downtown Salem in our existing local plans?
Are you asking how, like, in terms of the development process, how many units are planned? I know during the Our Salem project, we looked at the downtown and we looked at the corridors within a quarter mile of the core network that were zoned mixed use. I think CB, maybe river oriented mixed use. And our plan there was so that I think 35% of all of our dwelling units would be within those areas.
Now, just to clarify the question, Eunice, it's the adopted transportation. The city include detailed estimates of how many housing units over the next 25 years will be located in different parts of the city. So what I'm curious about is how the capacity estimate compares to those estimates that are in the adopted transportation plans of how many housing units will happen in downtown. Because my recollection is the total for downtown was maybe a couple of thousand.
Thanks for that clarification, Bob. I think I don't know the number offhand, but I think you're right in that the 13,000 that we think capacity-wise could fit in the downtown is high in terms of the number that we may actually see. And I think that's built into the rules. The 30%, there's a whole calculation that we have to do, assuming that every building could potentially redevelop, but only maybe 30% of those actually include housing. And so we are walking through the calculation to see, based on those assumptions, how many units would fit capacity-wise. I think it's a different question to say how many units on the ground through development applications are we seeing or do we think we'll see?
Great. Well,
I could just jump in. That's really the point of my question is, I think the idea behind these rules is we want to get 30% of all housing over the next 20 years in these kind of climate friendly areas. So the question is, can that really happen in Salem or in other places? Thanks.
Great. And I just would reiterate that I think, again, while we're drawing circles, you know, to comply with these rules for walkable mixed use areas, we have many other areas in the city that we are hoping will be walkable mixed use areas along our corridors and other places of the city, not just in the inner core.
So that leads us to the next question. What about State Street?
You know, I love State Street. Yeah. State Street is already zoned mixed use 1 and 2. So they would meet the rules in terms of heights and density for the walkable mixed use areas. I think where they fall short is that there is that 750 foot dimensional requirement. So the corridor like State Street is a bit narrow. It's only, I think, a half block or a block on each side of State Street. So wouldn't necessarily meet the rules in that sense.
Yeah, but it is zoned that way, and some of the street improvements are funded in the bond. So very exciting, which leads into the next question. How heavily is the mixed use planning taking into account bike lanes, especially protected bike lanes with corridors such as those outlined in the Salem Bike Vision Plan?
I will take that one. I think through the R Salem process, there was a lot of emphasis on how are we going to make these mixed-use areas more walkable and bike-friendly. And so that is directly driving our update to our transportation system plan. That update is going to look not only at the R Salem themes, but also these new state requirements. And we're not only going to be looking at how can we provide that, you know, high quality bicycle, pedestrian, and transit experience in the walkable, in this these downtown walkable mixed use areas, but really along all through all of our mixed use areas, because we did hear that from R Salem. And then in addition, the state rules call for that higher quality walking and biking facility, not only along in the walkable mixed use areas, but also along transit corridors that have frequent service. And that's where a lot of our mixed use areas are. So that really is part of that upcoming work.
Great. We have a question about if any of the units are going to be affordable in the mixed use developments.
So we don't have a requirement in Salem that development of housing in the downtown, for example, needs to include affordable units, but we do have incentives. So we have a multi-unit tax UTIP program where if you get that tax abatement, there is a requirement for housing that be affordable. We have other incentives for affordable housing, for example, like a system development charge. Is exempt from system development charges. So we have incentives, but we don't have requirements for affordable housing.
Could I just tag on to that? Because the other piece too is there's a component in the rules where, you know, local governments will establish these walkable mixed use areas. And then on an ongoing basis, there's reporting about housing production in these walkable mixed use areas. And one of the key things we're looking at is affordable housing in these areas. It's all through the framework of what's called a housing production strategy, which is kind of a larger document that cities over 10,000 will be producing on a regular basis to basically look at how, what are we doing to meet our community housing needs at a range of affordability levels and so on and so forth. So the reason this is important is that over time, we will learn what tools are most effective to promoting affordable housing, not just in walkable mixed use areas, but make sure that we have affordable housing in walkable mixed use areas. So we're not saying all affordable housing needs to be there, but we certainly don't want no affordable housing to be located in these areas. Obviously that works against our equity goals. So that was kind of a long-winded, convoluted way to explain it, but there's a longer term process of monitoring and learning over time what effective strategies will get us the housing production in these areas.
And I'll note that in Salem, we plan to kick off that housing production strategy, hopefully this year, so stay tuned.
Shane, did you want to add anything about affordable housing in Kaiser?
Sorry. In Kaiser, we don't currently have a requirement either. I do think that that is something that as we look at some of our equity analysis work and mitigation possibilities, that could be one of those levers that a city chooses to exercise to say, hey, there's certain requirements for affordable housing in certain areas or a certain percentage. I mean, I think that's something that a city could choose to do, but currently, it is really developer driven in Kaiser. So thanks, Lisa.
Great. And the next question is for you as well from Zach. River Road, currently pretty unwalkable, particularly infrequent pedestrian crossings. What degree of pedestrian enhancements along River Road do you expect would be enacted with the WAMUA planning zoning efforts?
Sure. Yeah, it's a great question, Zach. I know that's something that, you know, our city has identified desires or needs for some mid-block crossings on River Road for a long time. And when we went through the revitalization plan, as I said, there was an element of that plan, a big element of that plan that talked about the transportation network and connected bike facilities to connect to the adjacent neighborhoods to get people in and out without cars and, you know, different alternate modes. I think there was like three options that were identified in the revitalization plan for an actual redesign of River Road. Those were kind of paused. The city council did not adopt a specific, hey, this is what River Road's going to look like into the future. So we do have standards for redevelopment that provide separated sidewalks and things like that. But I would anticipate that as we go through the process of designating the walkable mixed-use areas, because they're all kind of interconnected, you kind of have these walkable mixed-use areas kind of coupled with the scenario planning efforts that we're going to be doing as a region, that's going to inform an update to our transportation system plan. So I don't have a super clear crystal ball on where that all lands, but what we do know is that those issues of a lack of mid-block crossings, they need to be addressed. Obviously, bike facilities and how that works with River Road, that needs to be addressed better than what it is today. And so that's kind of what the desire is that we would move that process forward. Hopefully that kind of answers the question.
Great, thanks. And Jeffrey had a comment about Radburn and how New Jersey, how it's had a huge influence on European planning, especially separating vehicles from pedestrians, but we don't see that a lot in the US. You can see it in Sun River and parts of Bend, and maybe that could be a goal for Salem's transportation plan update. That's a great comment. And then Selena wants to know if climate-friendly areas impact our ability to expand the UGB in the future.
I guess I'll jump in. Maybe I'm the right person to answer that. I'm also somebody who evaluates urban growth boundary expansions for the department. So we were careful in putting these rules together to make sure that we're not impairing cities' abilities to expand as population grows. And in fact, the walkable mixed-use areas will help to prove up, if you will, there's a component of the UGB expansion rules that says before a city expands an urban growth boundary, they need to look at efficiency measures to make more efficient use of lands within the current urban growth boundary. Well, walkable mixed-use areas are inherently an efficiency measure, and they will count towards that goal. And so there will be more efficient growth into the future. That's part of the whole concept of the walkable mixed-use area. But no, they will not impair or impede a local government's ability to expand the UGB as needed in the future.
Great, thanks, Kevin. Next question is from Mo. What other cities in Oregon or other states have we benchmarked that have been successful in promoting mixed use? And what have we learned from them?
I'll take that, I guess. So we're always looking at other cities, bigger cities, right? We look at cities in the Portland area, Bend, Eugene. But I will say, whenever we go to some sort of conference with planners, and we're always talking about trying to promote these walkable mixed-use areas, I think one of our takeaways is that it's not enough just to do zoning, right? We need the infrastructure improvements. We need the financial incentives to actually make the development work. And I think, some of the frustration that maybe we hear from the community in Salem is that now that we've rezoned it, why aren't we seeing the development? I think it's because zoning is just one component and planning one component of actually creating these walkable mixed use areas. And I think these rules are trying to get at that, also looking at the transportation, but also financial incentives, like how can we help developers make this happen?
Great.
I think Eunice's answer was really good.
Build star. Jeffrey, can we separate protected bike paths from vehicular lanes and create striped bus lanes and wider pedestrian walks, all with connectivity throughout the city? Seems like a question for Julie.
At least for the Salem side, Kaiser might have their own answer. I would say that when we update the TSP, Transportation System Plan, we will definitely be looking at that, looking at what the possibilities are. We do have to operate within our, to a certain extent, within our built environment, and financial constraints. So all those things we'll be talking about trade-offs.
And I'll jump in. Julie is an actual transportation planner, so she's definitely a lot smarter than I am when it comes to this kind of a question. What I will say about the city of Kaiser is we have definitely been looking at those opportunities whenever we can. It was really like that was a big element of our revitalization plan, the reality for people to feel comfortable, not just that facilities are there, but the bike level, the stress level on the bicyclists, if it's really high, they're less likely to use those facilities. So as we've looked at some projects, we have a Wheatland Road corridor project that we went through and did design work here recently. And that was looking at separated lanes where you could get them or, possibly having a larger, wider lane. And so that is something that I think all of those options are definitely on the table. And as far as Kaiser is concerned, I know that is a priority that bicycle and pedestrian facilities be high quality and comfortable to use and effective. So that's definitely a goal. But Julie's absolutely right. The constraints of available land with right-of-way and costs of construction and just practicality is sometimes difficult. And so cities have to kind of choose what's the best thing that we can do with what we've got to work with.
Great, thanks. Jeffrey is wondering, what is the definition of affordable housing?
Sure. In Salem, we're talking about housing that's affordable to the households that make up to generally 80% or less of the area median income. So we're not talking about smaller units, likely subsidized units, but we're really talking about housing that's affordable to a certain income bracket.
Great. That is the last question in the chat. I know there were a few people that raised their hand that didn't end up putting your question in the chat. If there's somebody that wanted to say their question out loud, we're unable to put it in the chat. I think we have a minute or two. We could take that. So anybody? Don't see anybody raising their hand. Okay. Any other final comments from staff that we want to make besides, obviously we want to thank everybody for coming. And like we said at the beginning, we did record it and we're going to post it on our websites and send it out so you can share it with people that weren't able to make it today. Shane, did you have any final comments? Oh, no, I hear questions.
Hey, Lisa?
Yeah.
Bob Corbett, I wanted to ask one more question, and I think this got covered. That you said that the materials, the analysis that Mid-Willamette Valley Council of Governments has done on the capacity of the different areas is going to be posted, or is it posted on the website, the Salem in Motion website, or when will that be available?
That information hasn't been posted yet, but eventually it will be. They're still working on the technical memos, if that's what you're referring to, Bob.
So I think
I guess that was the question, the timing. When would that be available to look at?
Wouldn't that be when it, I mean, we have to have that for the study that gets submitted by the end of December. So I would hope we would have it before that.
But if I understood correctly, you said that the analysis estimated there were 13,000 units of capacity in downtown. So isn't there something available to look at now?
We have some drafts. And so when those drafts are finalized, we'll put them online, Bob.
Thank you.
No, thank you. Any other questions? Any final comments from anybody? Shane or DLC, did anybody want to say anything besides thanking everyone for coming?
No, I think from my perspective, just thank you so much for everybody who attended. Hopefully the information that was provided was somewhat helpful in framing up the projects that we're in the midst of. And I do want to reiterate, thank you, Salem, for kind of putting this together and inviting Kaiser to participate. Thank you, Kevin and Evan, for your expertise and the good presentation part at the beginning to kind of lay the framework for it. So yeah, looking forward, if you're Kaiser people, looking forward to hopefully continuing to engage with you when we get our public open house scheduled. Show up and kind of do a drop-in format. We want to hear from you.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Have a good day. Bye.
Thanks.